live. Welcome to Data on the Edge, where I, Jeff Mills, CRO of iMerit, speak to industry-leading technology executives and providers on how best to deal with the data problem in the ML operations landscape. Today, I'm joined with Datasaur CEO Ivan Lee, a serial entrepreneur with a previous exit under his belt. He's built a cutting-edge data annotation platform that iMerit has partnered with specifically on NLP and content-centric workflows. Datasaur is a Y Combinator-backed startup that iMerit and I have had the pleasure of working with for the past 60 months or so, and I welcome Ivan to the podcast. Welcome, Ivan.
Hello, Jeff. It's good to see you.
It's great to see you. So I can sit here and do a big introduction for Datasaur. I think you'll do it better than I will. So I'd love for you to start by giving our audience maybe a little elevator pitch on Datasaur.
Sure. So Datasaur creates a data labeling software platform focused on text and audio. In order to power all the AI solutions around us today, it turns out you need a lot of labeled data, training data. And we make it really easy to handle, transform your text data into something that these AI models can learn from.
And I think, you know, going through that, edge cases has popped up to be one of the areas that a lot of our customers, mutual customers, have run into situations with. I think today you're going to go ahead and show us a bit about kind of where you sit in the data operations workflow, and primarily kind of some of the tools you have to deal with those edge cases. So I'd love to see that. Is that something you feel comfortable jumping into now?
Yeah, let's do it. So let me set the stage for where we are with natural language processing. As I started Datasaur as a company, there were a lot of tools already focused on images and video, but natural language processing was the sub-branch of AI that was really focused on the human language and what we could do with it. And as it turns out, there's a lot of different use cases out there. People started with very basic kind of language parsing with part of speech, named entity recognition, the NLP basics. But as we got deeper into this, and as we spoke with more teams around the world, it turns out there's a lot of really interesting applications out there. And we had to build our tool in order to support all of these edge cases. So it's easiest to just visualize by showing you exactly what Datasaur looks like. Welcome to Datasaur here. And we've got a number of Yelp reviews. So we just pulled these off the net. And in a traditional sense, people may have just done basic sentiment analysis. Overall, are the reviews for this restaurant good or bad? Turns out that's sometimes overly simplistic. These reviews may be quite nuanced, right? So what you can do in Datasaur is you can say, look, this teriyaki chicken, this is the best, right? The rice is perfectly cooked, but there may be something else, like the soup was cold. So being able to do something called aspect-based sentiment analysis, that's the kind of thing that our customers turn to us for, and the kind of thing that you can't really do on spreadsheets or some of the existing tools. Being able to draw a relationship between, you know, one sentiment and the corresponding attribute, so you can get a much more nuanced view of what exactly it is that they're praising or something that they're not happy with.
What other areas of the Datasaur platform do you think are making your customers, you know, happy with working within the platform? I know I can give you some of those answers from the iMerit side, that you guys are easy to work with and flexible. But I'm curious what other partners are bringing up as kind of key factors in why they're using the Datasaur platform.
Yeah. So for Datasaur, we approached this as we wanted to build the best tool possible for this from the ground up. And perhaps it's easiest to understand with an analogy. Let's say your design team today was asked to create all your mockups in Microsoft Paint. That's essentially where the industry is right now, right? It's possible you can absolutely get to pixel perfect mockups, but it's going to take a lot longer and it's going to be much more of a challenge, right? So imagine now somebody introduces something like Photoshop or Figma, which was custom built for this purpose, with team collaboration in mind, with a lot of these shortcuts and power tools for power users. That's how we approach Datasaur. So we have kind of three product pillars we like to talk about. One is building the most powerful and simplistic interface for labeling. And that allows you to do what I just demonstrated here with this aspect-based sentiment analysis. We also build intelligence in, right? It was silly to me because in my previous jobs, we used to go through and label everything from scratch. You'd be labeling things like Starbucks and Saturday and London manually every time. And that was just silly because we knew what those things were already, right? So we can pre-apply those labels and save you a lot of that time and effort. And then finally, it's the collaboration. It's the workflow management, being able to, you know, understand how far along is your team, have dashboards and reporting so you can see, you know, who is doing well. Are we going to meet this deadline to have all this labeled data by the end of next week, right? We wanted to build that integrated into the platform. So I would say when we entered the industry, people were still kind of playing around with what the best interface was for this. We wanted to have a holistic integrated approach and make sure it was really easy for anyone to get started and have all the tools they needed in one place.
Yeah, and I think when you bring up the you know, what I'll call label memory for this conversation, you probably have a better term for it. But you know, that definitely adds throughput increases, you know, in a significant manner, I think, when you already have those pre-labels set in there, and then quality obviously jumps with it as well. Are there any trends you're seeing across the industry right now, specifically with NLP? And then I guess my follow-up question to that is going to be, do you see yourself moving more into image and video and these other sectors outside of NLP over time? Because you guys are doing such a great job with the NLP interfaces themselves. I'm sure you guys could add a lot of value to video and image as well.
Thanks, Jeff. So as far as trends, let me kind of just continue elaborating on where NLP is today, right? If we look at the advances in NLP over the last few years, there have been some really exciting developments, perhaps most notably OpenAI's GPT-3, right? And their ability to just really start mimicking humans in generating this snippets of English language. So I think there's a lot of hype and excitement around where this technology could take us as a society. What we've noticed is that perhaps of all the branches of AI, NLP is one of the most mature and directly applicable. And there were some obvious use cases when we were starting out. There's things like the ability to handle customer support, improve upon chatbots, right? These were very clear verticals that we wanted to go after. But as we learned more, it turns out there's applications in the legal industry, in healthcare, in financial. There were a number of nonprofit organizations using us to label COVID-19 research and be able to just make sense of all the abundance of research that was coming out. People trying to download kind of restaurant menus and identifying, hey, this is a soup, this is a salad, this is a soup and salad combo. We were kind of astounded by the creativity and the ways in which NLP could be produced. So that's what we're focused on right now, is just supporting all of the NLP use cases out there. I'll also add on the fact that a lot of the advances have been in English and Mandarin, because that's where a lot of the research has been done. So we're working with researchers and companies around the world to even catch up and build those basics out, right? We've got customers in Indonesia, in Thailand, in Israel, working with non-English, non-Mandarin languages and building out the basic NER and getting a lot of the low-hanging fruit out of the way. So that's where we are right now with text. Our roadmap moving forward is moving into text adjacent spaces. So for me, I classify audio and OCR, optical character recognition, as text adjacent, because in these cases, you are transcribing audio and images into text, and then you're doing a lot of the same things that we were already supporting in the text space.
Yeah, and like, there's this big term, you know, being thrown around, audio is the new UI. And so I think there's gonna be so much work in this space. Especially as audio becomes, you know, a complete user interface. We're already seeing it, obviously, with devices in our homes. I think you're going to start seeing it a lot more in the autonomous mobility space. You're going to start seeing it in a lot of different areas. And it seems like you guys are really positioning yourselves to take on that space in a big way. We've loved working with you guys on these types of projects. Would be curious to get your feedback on how it's been to partner with iMerit on these types of projects in the past. How iMerit's helping you guys, and you know, the benefits you see coming from the iMerit side.
Yeah, absolutely. So iMerit's been one of our absolute best partners to date, right? In particular, I've appreciated and I've learned from iMerit's years of experience in the field. Being able to just consult with the end clients on how to best set up their labeling projects, and really making sure that they have, that you know, you as iMerit have the client's best interests at heart. And together, I think it's this perfect complementary partnership. When you join the best labeling workforce with the best labeling software, then jointly we can deliver the, you know, best experience end to end for our clients.
I really appreciate you saying that. So Ivan, Andrew Ng has created some interesting discussions around data-centric versus model-centric approaches when it comes to training machine learning algorithms. Do you see them as being two different things, or do you see them really as one complete solution?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. So let's draw an analogy to, let's say we had to create a website together, right? When you're creating a website, are design and engineering different things? Are the back end and the front end two distinct projects? I think at the end of the day, it's just about how zoomed in you are, right? It can make sense to draw a distinction between the two, but from an executive's perspective, perhaps all you really care about is at the end of the day, the website is done and built, right? So I think that's how I view ML, being ML-centric versus data-centric. Like, you have to do both at the end of the day. What I do want to call out is that in the industry and kind of where technologists are interested, MLOps is the side that gets a lot of the attention. It's fun toying with the latest models, right? Hypertuning those parameters and really making sure that you get it to the right place. But pragmatically speaking, and this has been, you know, we've seen this in research papers time and again, we often find that improving the quantity and the quality of the data is actually the fastest way forward to making improvements. You can stick with a two-year-old model and improve the training data that you provide that model, and you'll see a significant increase in performance. And so, you know, even when in my previous roles working with ML engineers at Apple and at Yahoo, it was important to kind of talk to my engineers and say, hey, it'll be really cool to kind of test out this new research paper. But if we need to meet this deadline in a couple of months, I really think this, you know, focusing on the data will probably give us the you know, best bang for the buck. So I would just want to make sure we don't underestimate the data-centric approach here.
Yeah, I think that's really fair. The data-centric approach is also, from my perspective, bringing up a lot of different types of users within the space, right? So, you know, we're starting to have to report on the data very differently, report on the throughput differently, the quality differently, fill the gaps in their models by building very specific data sets that need to go in now to make the model more robust. I think the edge cases that we're talking about right now as well really feed into that, right? Because once you start getting into production, once you start getting into wide production, it's all about the edge case and the nuance. And those edge cases and nuances are really hard to, I think, build models around. Those edge cases and nuances come by providing the model with the right data. So, you know, I think it's really a fascinating conversation. And you start to see it, right, as kind of progress within the companies we're working with. As they get further down the road, their teams start to break out a bit differently than they do when it's kind of a smaller company and you're working with the data engineer, like, from the beginning, then eventually start working with these large companies and they have multiple departments, and it starts to change the way we build our tools though. And so that's partly why I was thinking about it was, are you seeing the requests around reporting and showing kind of the insights around the data that's being created? Is that changing for you quickly within your products?
Yeah, absolutely. What I am seeing is that customers are getting more sophisticated. Users are getting more sophisticated in the way they analyze these projects, the way that they break things down, right? So I'm actually going to screen share again and kind of showcase our current dashboards, because as it turns out, it's not just about checking, you know, this one is focused on when are these projects going to be completed, right? And how efficient is everything running? But what we're getting a lot of folks asking us about are the quality trends, right? Understanding, being able to break down by project, how often are these labelers in agreement with one another, right? Because if you start seeing a lot of green and people are starting to agree with one another, that can often be a good sign. But if there's a lot of disagreement, is it because somebody needs more training? Or if there's disagreement across the board, what that's an indicator of is the fact that perhaps our labeling task was too ambiguous to begin with, right? And so being able to pull these insights from your labeling task and getting that feedback as to what you can tweak to make the whole process work better, that's what the industry is starting to learn these days.
If there's one thing that you would like our audience to know about Datasaur, one thing, just one thought, one feeling, one thing you want them to walk away from listening to this podcast, what would it be?
My plea for the audience is please don't reinvent this internally, right? I think I've personally seen the same tool at the three last companies that I worked at. I see too many customers come to us thinking that you can just build a quick web app to kind of service this need, but it turns into a 6-month project, a 18-month project with three engineers all updating and maintaining and getting a lot of client requests. You wouldn't reinvent Photoshop or Figma for your designers. So don't reinvent the wheel here.
Ivan, really appreciate you spending time with us today. What's the best way for people to get in touch with you?
The easiest way is probably via LinkedIn. Come find me there. I am generally responsive and would love to connect.
Ivan, thanks a ton for joining us today on Data on the Edge. Again, I'm Jeff Mills, CRO of iMerit. We'll talk to you again next time. Thanks.